Would you like to be a badass? Like this? Then this video is just for you, because you can be just like me if you follow my instructions. Because what I do is actually quite easy, but most people have no clue, because there's no accessible information on the internet about breeding butterflies and moths in captivity. And guess what? They're not the most popular pets. They can be a little tricky to keep, but here's all the info and all the basics that you need, right? Let's get started. First, the life cycle of a butterfly or moth consists of multiple stages. The egg, the caterpillar, the cocoon, and the adult. This is because they have a metamorphosis, and each and every stage they need different care. This makes them maybe a little bit more difficult than pets like, say, stick insects or mantis or cockroaches, because, you know, those kind of insects have a hemimetabolism. Let's pop the word right here. It's a difficult word, hemimetabolism. They are hemimetabolous, which means they don't go through metamorphosis, but butterflies and moths have a holometabolism, which means they'll have a complete metamorphosis, and each life stage has different needs and different care. All right, let's go through it now. Phase one, eggs. Eggs are probably the most easy to take care of in captivity, and are probably the most easy life stage, because the eggs of most butterflies and moths will hatch in a few weeks' time, and we'll do fine on room temperature. Personally, I hatch them in petri dishes. Let's show you a video. Yes, that's right. These are petri dishes, and you can order them online very cheaply. You can, like, for a few dollars, you can order 100 of them. So what's important for eggs is keep them on room temperature, don't overheat them. Yes, they do need slight humidity, you can spray them if you like, but don't overdo it. A few times per week is enough. Too much humidity will cause moisture and mold on the eggs. However, not all eggs will hatch within a few weeks. There are a few butterflies and moths that overwinter in the egg stage. Yes, that's right. You can overwinter those outside if your garden is cold enough in winter. That means if you don't live in Siberia, where they will probably freeze to death in winter. You can also use the fridge, but be careful, the fridge can desiccate the eggs. Let's show you one example of how to overwinter eggs.
I made a fun discovery. And here's some eggs I'm overwintering. Here is a tube. This moth overwinters as eggs. It's a rare species from Taiwan. It's Caligula tibeta. You should Google that name. Caligula tibeta. It looks like a Saturnia, but very colorful with night accents of red.
I just keep them in a plastic box in my shed, and in spring I warm them up and they hatch after having been cold for several months. But the majority of them, I put them in plastic containers and petri dishes, and they will be fine. Excellent. Stage two, the caterpillar. Now, caterpillars, they are complicated, guys. This is probably the most complicated stage. First of all, it seems very straightforward, but what do caterpillars need? First of all, food. This one is obvious. Butterflies and moths are specialists. They will not eat every kind of food. In fact, they will starve. They will starve to death before they will try to eat a plant they are unfamiliar with. You must study them well. Look up what their host plants are, right? You can't just take one random plant and feed it, no. They're specialists. For example, cabbage white butterflies will only feed on plants from the cabbage family. So, and things like death's head hawk moth, they prefer plants from the nightshade or the olive family. But don't try to feed them oak or lettuce. You have to look up the biology very well and study them and find the optimal plants for them, right? This is the most important thing. And what's confusing is sometimes caterpillars will feed on a plant that's not the best plant for them, actually. This means that they will die, and because the plant was not optimal for them. And sometimes the host plants of a caterpillar are not even known if you breed very obscure or rare species. And you have to experiment a little. Look at other species in the family. What do they eat? Compare it. And then you can find a substitute. Second of all, ventilation. Many people kill caterpillars by cramming them in plastic boxes. Yes, that's right. Plastic boxes can be excellent. But plastic boxes only work for species that handle the highest degree of humidity and high population density, because it's easy to overcrowd caterpillars in a container. Within an airtight plastic container, pathogens will grow. Bacteria, fungi, all of them are dangerous. All of them will easily grow in a closed, airtight plastic container. Don't give them the plastic death, guys. Use rearing cages. Or, even better, take a branch of host plant and put them in a bottle of water like this.
So, hi there, viewers. Today I have a new species, which I'm about to show. This time it's actually a butterfly and not a moth. And it's actually a special butterfly too. I'll show the larva. This is my setup. A wine bottle filled with water, and I just include some twigs. Here are some of the larvae. They are camouflaged like bird poop. Let me see if I can get a good shot of this one. Yeah. And it's actually a butterfly from Asia called Papilio de Hani. So I have them here in a bottle of liquid amber tree, and they're generally growing very well. And I hope that later this year I can show all of you, my viewers, some beautiful Citheronia moths and the fully grown larva. Thanks for watching.
You've seen the examples, now you know what to do, guys. Try and emulate my method. Don't use plastic boxes. I have negative experience with them, and that's right, if you look at my YouTube channel, you'll see me breeding a few species in plastic boxes, but these are the exception, not the rule. And I know the species I keep in plastic boxes very well, and I know they can handle it. That's another thing.
Oh, and by the way, you'll notice that many of the plastic boxes that I used to rear still have some sort of ventilation, so air can flow through. This is important, people. See, this is a fauna box. Yes, this is the exact name of it, a fauna box. If you Google the word online, you'll get some sources where you can buy them. It has a removable lid. See, there we go. And inside is revealed a small treasure of Automerus caterpillars. Alright, I'm filming them in very terrible lighting. But to be honest, I'm not trying to show off the larva, I'm just trying to show you the box that I used to rear in. Once again, stressing the importance of proper ventilation, if this box did not have
a ventilated see-through part where air can flow through, these larvae would probably be dead already. That's how important this is, guys. That was all. Some species I do rear in completely closed plastic boxes like this, but very rarely, and I do not encourage beginners to do this because it has more risks than gains. But here we have some very young hatchlings of a Lesiocampidae moth, an agar moth from Europe. It is the Streblote panda. And generally it's okay to rear the young instars in closed plastic boxes because they do not need as much ventilation as the adults do. So rearing the first few instars in plastic boxes is generally okay. But once the caterpillars grow bigger, they will need more ventilated and bigger boxes, or actually preferably cages. And consider using the fauna boxes I showed you in my previous video. The biggest mistake for beginners is to try and rear everything in plastic boxes, and I must really stress this. This is one of the biggest mistakes that beginners make, and it will cause infections. You know, the caterpillars will become wet and they will just die. They will completely melt, like some insect version of the Ebola disease. You know, sticky goo will leak out and it's all just terrible. Now, caterpillars, another thing is very important, is they need hygiene and fresh food. Caterpillars are very sensitive to filth because they have a very weak immune system. They can get sick very easily. Why? Because their immune system, they don't have active immunity. They cannot become immune to new pathogens. They have a very general immune system, and they are not used to living in the high density they are forced to live in captivity. In nature, caterpillars don't live in their own filth. They don't live in their own feces. They don't live together with so many caterpillars. Of course, they're social species, they are the exceptions. Generally, they don't live in big groups together. It's kind of dirty for them, you know. That's why they can become infected so fast. So hygiene is very important. Infections are a real killer. But also you have things like viruses or whatever. It's a good idea to disinfect containers if you are going to rear a new species in them. If your caterpillars become sick, put them in a new container and disinfect the old container. Sometimes I disinfect containers using Clorox or bleach or whatever. Whatever it takes. Second of all, ventilation and airflow is very important for them. It also helps prevent bacteria from growing within a container because the conditions in a container are optimal for them.